Welcome to Investor's Guide. Happy Diwali to you and to your family. I hope you have a wonderful year full of prosperity. I have a special treat for you this Diwali on Investor's Guide. I'm sitting down with one of India's most respected investors and one of the most respected voices of our stock market. He's going to share with us his investment philosophy and tell us how getting rich over the long term is actually a very, very simple thing. Ramdev Agarwal, thank you so much for joining us. Happy Diwali to you. Such a pleasure to sit down with you.
Yeah, happy Diwali to you and all the viewers who have joined to listen to both of us.
Ramdev, I'm going to start with the most common question we get on all of our emails of investors who write into us. They say simply this: the market looks fantastic right now. It's looked fantastic since the beginning of this year. Is it the time to get in? Should we wait for it to seem a little softer? Should we get in right now? Should we use SIPs? There are a lot of investors who are looking for that entry point, feeling like they've missed the run-up that we've seen up till now. What is your advice to someone who wants to get into this market at this point, who's perhaps, let's hope, looking at it from a long-term point of view?
You know, as far as timing is concerned, that I have been in the market for 35 years. Nobody can predict this market. And yet everybody is busy in doing that. So this is the biggest curse of the market, that everybody is trying to time not 1 year moment, 2 year moment, but even a daily and hourly moments.
Yes.
Okay. So I think timing is almost impossible. Even probably God cannot predict the market. So every single investor trying to buy into weaknesses and all, buy in so-called dips and all, is all, in my the same scheme of things, is all useless. You must buy when you have the money, and you must sell when you need the money. And if you bought it reasonably well, and if you are not that confident, you can do, at best you can do SIP. But you have to just keep getting into the equities and stay long. And the markets will correct after you buy. But that doesn't mean that you should be scared of market timing. The time to buy is now, and time to buy is whenever you have the money.
In India, we have a tendency to put our money into three of our favorite investments. It is Diwali, but gold being one of them, real estate being another, and fixed deposits being the third.
Yeah.
Yet somehow we always manage to ignore equity. Where we are standing today, in the long-term view of our market, how important is it for us to, each of us, include equity in our portfolio and make sure that it's a fairly sizable chunk of our portfolio?
So let's first get to understand what is investing means. What exactly is all these three things trying to achieve? That is investing. Okay. What do you want to do? You want to make your money work for you. And how does it work for you? When you can accumulate purchasing power. Today, when you part with a crore and whatever it buys in physical terms, after 10 years, it should be able to buy 3-4 times more than what it can buy today. So inflation adjusted, you should be able to accumulate more purchasing power for your savings. That's the whole idea. Now what happens is, when you go to gold and fixed income, they are basically inflation beaters. I mean, at best, inflation equalizer, not beater. Inflation is always post-tax, and the earnings from the fixed income is pre-tax. So barely they do equalizing. So it doesn't create wealth for you. After 10 years in India with 8-9% inflation, if you get your purchasing power back with the help of your fixed income instruments, you should be very lucky. So obviously you are not doing any investing. The money is not working for you if you go to fixed income. I am very clear about it. The only way it can work for you is either you go to real estate or you go to equities. But equity is something which can give you 34 track record is about 17.5% without outperformance. The index itself has done 17%. So inflation is about 8-9%. So clearly equity is the way to go, but equity has everyday quotations. So a lot of people don't have appetite to have equity in the portfolio. But still, minimum you should have, worst of the guys, most conservative guy, should have at least 25% of the allocation in the portfolio. And the most aggressive guy, like me, would also always have 100%, but at least you can go up to 75%.
I want to ask you this. On the 2nd of September, you wrote an article in the Economic Times where you said you expect the Sensex to be at 28 or 30,000 maybe by the end of March. You also said a lot depends on the new government's ability to fulfill the promises it's made. So I want to ask you two things. One is, do you still believe that we're looking at 30,000 on the Sensex at the end of this financial year? And are you happy with what you've seen with this new government so far?
I think the next big event, economic event, would be the next budget, when this government will seriously present their thought process and what they want to do and some big bang reforms, and I mean that's what my sense is. So there will be, in the expectation, there will be good rally at that point of time. But meanwhile, the crude oil price, which has been at about 110 when I said this, has today crumbled to more like 88, 89, and it's still going down. So I think if at that time I was thinking 30,000, now it should be 35,000 at least. So I mean that's what the events make me believe. Whether it will happen or not, I mean there are a lot of external things happening. Firing is happening at the border. Global economy is slowing down. So I mean a lot of things can play out. But I'm fairly certain that under the leadership of Mr. Modi and the new government, next 5 years is going to be very interesting. I mean minimum should be down. Minimum stock should be doubling. I mean index should be doubling in 5 years. If I mean if things work out, it might be 3 times.
Right. So anybody who stays out of this market will be horribly disappointed with themselves.
No, everybody has their own style. I mean, if somebody has made a lot of money out of their whatever ventures they have, and they don't want to take further interest in the stock market, they should be fine in the sense that they can be with fixed income or whatever. But my sense is, seriously, somebody wants to make money, India is the place to invest in.
Right, we have a couple of Twitter questions that have come in for you on my feed. Vikas Agarwal has written in. He asked you to share your investment philosophy, and he said, you say buy right, sit tight. Hmm. How does one buy right? How do we know that a stock holds the potential that we can buy and we can, you know, just wait on it?
Yeah. Buy right, sit tight is such a common thing that any investor, whether whatever be my style and what would be your style, you must buy right and sit tight. So what is buy right? As per us, we have a quoted framework that is called quality, growth, longevity at reasonable price, QGLP we call it. So what is quality? Quality of business run by quality of management. High quality business run by high quality management. Then the growth. Understanding 2 years growth is a science, but understanding 10, 15, 20 years of growth is an art. So you have to focus on the high quality business run by high quality management with a high growth for the longevity period. And fourth is, so the QGL, and that you should be able to buy at a reasonable price. Not very cheap price, but it has to be reasonable price. By chance you get these stocks at bargain price, so the process becomes QGLB, quality, growth, longevity at bargain price. Back up the truck and load the stuff. But you rarely get that particular opportunity. See, in stock market, it is not important what you bought and how much you bought. What is actually important is how long you stayed. Because companies are not built overnight. You're seeing Infosys what is happening. They had a leadership transition problem, and now they got a wonderful guy called Sikka, and they're again back on track. So these things happen in even greatest possible company. You know, in our time, I think Infosys is one of the biggest, I mean, greatest company which India has ever given. So even those companies, you can have some transitory problems. So, but you should not lose faith in these, you know, kind of companies and journey of the companies. So how much time you spend? People came in 94 in a flopped issue at 200 crores market cap. Today it is 220,000 crores market cap. It is more than 1,000 times in 20 years. So what is important is how long you stay. And you buy a few of them, some of them will not work, some of them will work. But you can lose in portfolio strategy, you can lose 1x. But when you succeed, you can be 1,000x.
All right, so what have we learned in this segment so far? That the market is sounding really promising over the next 5 years. Not if you're in for less than 5 years, though. We're looking at buy that, sit tight, and of course, QGLP. When we come back from the break, we'll talk about what we should do if we find all of this too complicated. Are mutual funds the answers for us? Or how should we find good advisors? That's on the other side. Don't go anywhere. Welcome back. You're watching Investor's Guide in ET Now. Thank you for staying with us. For those of you who just tuned in, I'm sitting down with Ramdev Agarwal. He's sharing with us his investment philosophy, and we're trying to learn as much as possible so we can in this short period of time. Ramdev, I want to ask you this. Of course, we talked about the first half of Buy Right, Sit Tight. I want to talk about the second half. Now, we do know that in this wonderful bull run that we saw over this year, the Nifty went up to 8,000, then came back down again. A lot of investors feel that, oh, maybe I missed an opportunity to sell. Maybe I should have sold at that point, taken some money out, because now the value of the stock has come down again. If I'm looking at a long-term view, 10, 15 years, does it make sense to just buy the stock and keep it for that long? Should I constantly look at it, do the research, check the results, find out whether or not I should sell? What is your advice for a retail investor?
Yeah, I think till about when I started my career, the mutual fund concept was not there. I mean, that's in that nascent stage. But in 90s and more particularly in last 10-15 years, we have given birth to a lot of mutual fund companies and a lot of mutual fund products. And there are some wonderful fund managers. So actually doing equity investing has become very complex, because now the stocks are not coming at par value. They are coming at full market price of 1000 rupees, 500 rupees, 300 rupees. And the data flow has become a lot and very complex. So if you are a very matured investor who has already found his style and you do wonderful job of investing yourself, you don't need anybody's help and you should not be watching this program. Okay. But the guy who is actually wanting to make money but who is not hooked onto the market, who doesn't mind sparing his money and giving it to an expert, it's like saying that I have a heart problem, so either I'm a doctor myself, I can treat myself, or I go to the best possible doctor available for a fee. And there are enough of them. You go and give it to one or two or three of them, and that should also be a portfolio of it. Say three managers. If you have say 30 lakhs, 10 lakhs each, you give it to three guys and watch how well they do it. And so your job is to select a intelligent, good investment manager, and the whole lot of history available, interviews available, and past performances available.
How does, which was going to be my next question, how do we select a manager? Now, there is a range also available to us, from even somebody who wants to put aside 5,000 rupees a month, he can choose a mutual fund advisor up to portfolio management services and wealth creation. How do we pick an advisor? How do we judge whether or not his advice is working for us?
No, so it is like judging a doctor. If you have a medical problem, if you have a heart problem, you have to figure out who's going to be a good. Good thing is that it's not about affordability. Everybody charges the same. I mean, in doctors, somebody charges a lakh, somebody charges 10,000, and somebody's free also. And probably the guy who's free is the best. So it's not like that here. Everybody charges at 2-2.5%, whatever comes. So actually, the pricing headache is not there with you. You have to only figure out who is the best. And there's so much of interviews available. There's so much, you can look at the portfolio. You can look at his investment strategy. And does it work at all on a 6 month basis, 3 month basis, 1 year basis, 3 year basis, 5 year basis? I mean, what else you want?
All right. As in the era of 24-hour news channels and the internet, I accept our blame also for this. There's a lot of information available.
Yeah, yeah.
There's a lot of noise being made about things like RBI policies, or the Federal Reserve making an announcement, or macro numbers. As a retail investor who's buying right and sitting tight, do I have to worry about these things, or are they irrelevant in the long
term? You said it right. These are all noise. I don't have a TV screen in my room. Because see, what happens in TV, they push you tons of stuff. I'm not saying they're bad, but I can't absorb tons of stuff. But whatever I want, little bit, one chapati, one sabji, I can call for it by internet or calling up somebody.
Also, we have a lot of people who write to us, both with mutual funds and stocks, 20 funds in a portfolio, sometimes 40 stocks in a portfolio. I mean, over diversification, if not anything else. If I were to ask you, if I'm starting off right now, how many mutual funds or how many stocks are ideal in terms of both paperwork and management and reaching ideal diversification?
See, we run everything very, very concentrated. I mean, I'm a guy who's ultimately focused. I have only one business, I have one house, and I have only one manager who's myself. Okay, and I have 100% equity. So I think as far as number of stocks are concerned, I think 15-20 stocks is max. So you must run a very focused, because if you actually are a good fund manager, then you should bring conviction on the table. Because what happens is, how do you make money in the market? Your knowledge of the business should be better than the market. Now, you cannot know more than 10-15 stocks better than market. And as you bring a number of companies smaller, fewer and fewer, your knowledge goes vertically up. Okay, so the market knowledge stays at one level, but your knowledge is here. So in few stocks you beat the market, but all the stocks put together, market will beat you down. So you got to have, diversification should be enough to keep you ahead of the market, but it should not be so much that you are below the market.
We talked about your other philosophies. I also found this very interesting thing on your website, that you have something called the next trillion dollar strategy. Tell us what that is.
Yeah, so what is the next trillion dollar? I'm not an economist, but everything is driven by the economics. So what is the macro macro outlook we have for India, which is called India the next trillion dollar opportunity. Now I'll take just about a minute and just explain you. What is whenever a country achieves a trillion dollar status, it becomes a very important market for the world. Now India took 60 years. In 47, our GDP was about $10 billion. In 2007, it became a trillion dollar. It took full 60 years to become a trillion dollar economy. And then suddenly India started getting mentioned in the global forum. And today, when we are achieving in 7 years the second trillion, it is becoming the global kind of a much more important than what it was, say, 10 years back. So it took 60 years for the first trillion, 7 years for second trillion. Third trillion will come in 3.5 to 4 years. Fourth trillion will come in 3 years. Fifth trillion will come in 2 years. And seventh or eighth trillion will come in just about a year. Now, what is the significance of this? When you reach about $1,000 per capita, your discretionary income is, discretionary spend is only $100. And your non-discretionary is about $900. That's a basic food, basic shelter and all. There's no corporate activity in essential food, only in discretionary. When you go from 1,000 to 2,000, your discretionaries go from 100 to 1,000. So what is a linear GDP growth rate is an exponential business opportunity. Six channels are not running at $500 per capita. Six business channels can run only in India, only when you have the $1,500 per capita GDP. If per capita GDP was say $800-$900, none of them would be existing, I can tell you this. So what happens is discretionary spend explode. And even in discretionary spend, some of them they exploded 30%, 40%, 50%. And some of them at about 15%, 17%, 20%. And the markets, and even the businessmen at times, don't know that exponentially is working behind the behind his back. It's like that airport, that runway. So that next trillion dollar theme is working for next 15, 20, 25 years wonderfully for India.
Now, I know that a lot of people keep asking what should we buy. I'm going to ask you what we should not buy in the market, because there's so many choices. And if you're going to stay focused on quality, would you say there are some maybe sectors or some ideas or some mistakes that we should avoid as investors altogether?
There are basically three types of companies. All the stocks put together, you can put in three buckets: great, good, gruesome. Okay, what is a great company? A company whom you give money at the beginning of the year, say 100 crores, it makes 120 crores. Next year, the same company, again you give 100 crores, it makes 125 crores. Then 35%, then 40%, then 50%, and 100%. There are companies like that. Okay, so that's a good, great companies. So there are only 35, 40 companies like that. At best, 50 companies out of 3,000 companies. Then you have a slightly larger category of good companies, where you give the money of 100 crores, it will make 20%, but if you want to double the profit from 20 to 40 crores, you have to give another 100 crores. So that's how the profit keeps multiplying, but it's a decent return, but it doesn't do any wonders. You have to make more, you have to put more, but at a slightly attractive level. The real problem is, this is only 15% of that entire listed company, so that's about 500 companies. Rest all 4,500 companies are gruesome. And that's what is the source of the trouble. And there are so many of them. Okay. Now, what is gruesome? Gruesome is the company which actually earns below cost of capital. Your cost of capital is 13, 14, 15%, and they earn 7%, 8%, 9%. And that is also not a problem, because that is not his problem. It's a legacy problem or something has changed outside. The problem is the person who is earning 7, 8%, he wants to double the size of his business. So what happens is, he's already running on say 10,000 crores, he is earning only 700 crores and all. Now he wants to go from 700 crores to 1,400 crores profit. For that he needs another 10,000 crores. To earn 700 crores, he will destroy another 10,000 crores. And still it is profit. There are companies which are making losses and they still want to expand. So they want to increase the losses. So I think the problem is finding the portfolio of companies which are made up of great and good. And you pay, in my view, the investors pay that 1.5%, 2%, 3%, whatever management fee they pay. 90% of the payment is for finding good companies away from the bad companies. And bad companies, they definitely find place in your portfolio, even in my portfolio. Forget about yours. It will find place in your in the name of cheapness. The moment they are about 3P, 4P, or somebody will come with the news that this guy is taking over this or that guy, it will come in your place and permanently it will become, because it will go below your purchase price, and then in good time you'll buy bad company and it will stay in your portfolio as a long-term investment and you never make money. So the one thing to avoid in this Diwali, from this Diwali onward, is don't buy low quality companies even if it is very cheap.
Alright, so don't buy low quality companies even if it's very cheap. We have to take another break, unfortunately. But when we come back, we'll talk about ETFs or index funds and find out if that's a safer way for those of us who are having trouble deciding. And we'll also ask Ramveer a couple of mistakes that he's made when he's been investing for the last 30 years. Don't go anywhere. Back. You're watching Investor's Guide on ET Now. Happy Diwali to you. I'm sitting down with Ramveer Agarwal and he's teaching us how we should be investing in this market. Ramveer, thank you so much for spending time with us. We have a couple of questions. Very interestingly, Priyesh Choksi has written in. He wants to know if you recommend futures trading for young investors. Futures trading and investors, somehow they don't go in the same sentence altogether.
I'm old type and I have seen, we run one of the largest broking houses. There are a lot of traders and they make money, they lose money, there are a lot of activity. But I have not come across anybody who has made serious amount of money only by trading. Most of the guys, they have hybrid character in the sense that 70-80% of the investments and 20-30% of the money used, they use margin or whatever, they keep trading. So, particularly young investor, first thing is he should be investor and he should be young. They should not start with the futures trading. If at all future trading has to be done, it has to be done with very matured guys at a much later stage. Because to understand the entire investing concept, and as you said, I think the future and futures trading and investing doesn't go together. Because investing fundamentally means asset performance. And when you do futures trading, it is only price performance.
Of course, on Diwali, we can't tell people not to gamble, but they should be prepared to lose everything if they're going to go in without knowing how it works. Sunil Doshi has written in. He says, what are the biggest mistakes you've made during your life as an investor in the last 30 years? I'll ask you for one or two, something we can learn from.
I think, first 15 years have been full of mistakes only. And only 94 when I read Warren Buffett's writings and all, I think I got so-called Buddhatva and got into a very disciplined investing style. But till then, it was, every other thing was a mistake type, you know. But more recently, you know, some things very recently I bought into a company called Financial Technologies. You know, very recent, still the memory is, fresh. I bought it 1,011 rupees and sold it 150 rupees. So, you know, when people caution you about bad management, I'm actually a little adamant in the sense that when I like a company, I like the business model. At times, I was lax about quality and management. I said, even if it is a B quality management, in terms of integrity, I think it will do. And that's where I think I got stuck. I think it was a very competent management, but very low on the integrity. And that's where I got stuck. I was very, great business, great competence, but lacking integrity. And that I got stuck. And everybody cautioned me against it. So I think investing knowingly into a bad management, more particularly in bad value system, is going to be very expensive. I will never do it. It will definitely cost me my number of choices of stocks, but definitely one should not buy a manager with a compromised value system. That doesn't go very far.
The Motilal Oswal mutual funds are doing really well. We review them on a regular basis on the show. The one that we found most interesting on Investor's Guide is the Most Shares NASDAQ, which did so brilliantly when the Indian market was struggling. Now that the Indian market has turned around, a lot of investors are turning their attention back to India. Do you think it's important for us to keep maybe a steady allocation to the global market through an ETF? Would that be a good thing to do?
Yeah, I think some amount of exposure to global equities. In equity markets, don't do anything unless you understand it. So if you have any doubts about outlook about US or tech sector in US, then obviously you should not have. But in my sense, in this digital age, one of the biggest things is the technology, and there is no other play than NASDAQ. And since it's a fairly deep diversified equity portfolio of topmost company, I think one should have some bit of allocation through NASDAQ ETF, and it has done very well.
And the beauty about those companies is they do business across the world and they're not specific.
Yeah, they're global companies. They're global technology proxy, and the portfolio also keeps churning. If Apple tomorrow becomes a user's company, they'll find some new Apple out there. Mm-hmm. So Google will be there or something else will be there. So I think we're always at the cutting edge of the technology investing.
The other question I wanted to ask you is for investors who find it too daunting a task to pick a specific fund, and let's be honest, our universe has a lot of funds to choose from right now. Can I just pick the Nifty ETF and stick with it for the next 5 years? Will that do the trick for me?
Yeah, that as far as the allocation is concerned, you are done with. I mean, you don't have to bother any joker who is promising you he can do this wonder, that wonder. And you are allocated. So whatever is the index equivalent, say if it does 17% or 20%, you are guaranteed of that at a very little expense. And the tracking will be almost close to it, plus minus 0.5%. So your equity allocation will be done. But if you want a kicker of outperformance, alpha, then you have to look for the manager.
I'm running out of time, but I very quickly want to ask you this. For all of our viewers who are tuned in, it is Diwali. As a gift, give them one piece of advice that they can use over the next 10 years.
Yeah, I think you must buy as much equity, and particularly Indian equities, and stay with them. Don't trade, don't time the market. And longer the period for which you stay, and even if you allocate 10% or 20% of your net worth, but stay long enough. Don't get scared. I mean, it will go up and down, but at the end of it, in equities, and particularly in quality equities, it is said, downs are temporary, ups are permanent. In bad equities, it is said, downs are permanent, ups are temporary.
All right. I'm not going to give up. I'm going to ask you for one more gift. If we get enough questions for you on the show, will you come back into the studio and answer all of our questions?
It's all for your viewers.
All right. So all you have to do if you have a question is write to us. Email ID is at the bottom of your screen, as is my Twitter handle and Ramdev's Twitter handle. It'll be our pleasure to hear from you. Send in as many questions as you like and we'll get him to come back into the studio and answer your questions for you. That's a wrap on Investor's Guide. Happy Diwali to you and your entire family. I wish you a year of prosperity, where all of your investments do really, really well. Stay with ET Now, and thanks for watching.